Hello there, and thank you for tuning in to see what the world looks like through atheist eyes. I'm Frank Zindler, and I'm your host for this series of programs that I've prepared for American Atheist Television. Today's program is titled Mythicist Books for the Atheist's Toolbox. It'll be show and tell about some books atheists need to have in their libraries in order to understand the dispute between scholars like me, who claim that Jesus of Nazareth was not an historical figure, and the majority of scholars, both atheist and theist, who believe that he once was a real man. Let me show you what I've prepared for you today. Guess who wrote this? These repeated forgeries and falsifications create a well-founded suspicion that all the cases spoken of concerning the person called Jesus Christ are made-up cases, on purpose to lug in, and that very clumsily, some broken sentences from the Old Testament and apply them as prophecies of those cases. And that, so far from his being the Son of God, he did not exist even as a man. That he is merely an imaginary or allegorical character, as Apollo, Hercules, Jupiter, and all the deities of antiquity were. There is no written history at the time Jesus Christ is said to have lived that speaks of the existence of such a person, even as a man. Well, that was written by the founding father, Thomas Paine, author of the name United States of America, as well as the writer of the history-changing pamphlets, Common Sense, The Rights of Man, and The Crisis. That shocking claim that Jesus never existed even as a man was made in the last book Paine ever published in his lifetime, Part 3 of The Age of Reason. It can be found in the annotated edition of that rare and little-known book that I published some years ago for American Atheist Press. Parts 1 and 2 of The Age of Reason are well known for their debunking of the Bible and Christianity. And Part 3 continues Paine's attack on Christianity, bearing the subtitle, Examination of the Prophecies. In it, Paine debunks the claim that there are prophecies of Jesus of Nazareth in the so-called Old Testament of the Christian Bible. I start with this book, not only to try to get you all to add it to your atheist toolboxes, it's still available from American Atheist Press and from Amazon, but also to show you that mythicism, the theory that Jesus of Nazareth is a mythical, not historical figure, has roots going far back in American history. Let me skip a little more than 200 years forward from the time Paine wrote those words, to read to you what I myself wrote in the foreword to another American Atheist Press book that I urge you all to get and read, Bart Ehrman and the Quest of the Historical Jesus of Nazareth, an evaluation of Ehrman's Did Jesus Exist? The struggle here engaged is not just another scholarly quarrel. It is a contest between scholars who see the world through the lens of science, and those who cannot yet cut themselves free from the anchors of religion and traditional authority. Until the publication in 2012 of Bart D. Ehrman's Did Jesus Exist? The Historical Argument for Jesus of Nazareth, scholars who have denied the historicity of Jesus of Nazareth have for the most part been answered only by religious apologists, not genuine historians or biblical scholars. Only occasionally during the 20th century did secular scholars take critical notice of the growing mythicist literature and present arguments against even the most uncertain and vulnerable parts of it. Everything changed, however, when the mythicist position was formally engaged by Professor Bart D. Ehrman, the James A. Gray Distinguished Professor of Religious Studies at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. Ehrman, arguably, is one of the most famous and professionally respected New Testament scholars in America. In his did Jesus exist, specific mythicists are named and their works are cited and criticized. This is a milestone in the history of historical Jesus studies, and it lends hope that before too long, a genuine science of Christian origins, a science of Christian origins, will be able to supplant historical Jesus studies in the world of secular scholarship. It just so happens that one of the scholars criticized in Ehrman's book was little old me, and this little old book here, volume one of my collected short works, and the source of the name for this series of programs, Through Atheist Eyes, Scenes from a World That Won't Reason. And this is volume one, Religions and Scriptures. In this volume are to be found several chapters that drew what I feel was misleading and inaccurate criticism from Ehrman. They were how Jesus got a life and where Jesus never walked. That was a critique of so-called New Testament archaeology. Well, what was it that the New York Times best-selling author wrote about me that prodded me into writing the better part of a 567-page book in response? Let me read to you page 212 of his book, Did Jesus Exist? Just to pick a more recent example, I might mention the assertions of Frank Zindler in his essay, How Jesus Got a Life. Zindler is not as extreme as Graves, but he does make unguarded claims about providing the reader any guidance for finding the supporting evidence. In Zindler's view, Christ's biography started as a set of astrological and comparative mythological speculations in a pagan mystery cult, based to a large extent on the ancient mystery religion of Mithraism. According to Zindler, the cult figure of the Mithras, the Persian god Mithras, was said to have been born on December 25th to a virgin. His cult was headed by a ruler who was known as a pope, located on the Vatican Hill. The leaders of the religion wore mitres and celebrated a sacred meal to commemorate the atoning death of their savior god, who was said to have been raised from the dead on Sunday. Sound familiar? The cult was centered, Zindler claims, in Tarsus, the hometown of the Apostle Paul. But then the astrologers involved with the cult came to realize that the zodiacal sign of Mithra was drawing to a close, since the equinox was moving into Pisces. And so they, quote, left their cult centers in Phrygia and Cilicia to go to Palestine to see if they could locate not just the king of the Jews, but the new time lord, unquote me. That is, they invented Jesus, is his parenthesis. Zindler says this in all sincerity, and so far as I can tell, he really believes it. What evidence does he give for his claim that the Mithras moved their religion to Palestine to help them find the king of the Jews? None at all. And so we might ask, what evidence could he have cited had he wanted to do so? It's the same answer. There is no evidence. This is made up. So, I made it all up. Since I never ever claimed that the Mithras, quote, moved their religion to Palestine, I never made that up. Ehrman made that up. But what about my actual claims that he asserts I made up out of thin air? Now, keep in mind that Ehrman's Did Jesus Exist was published in late spring of 2012. On August 5th of 2011, almost a year earlier, I received this email from Bart, in which he asked me for the very evidence that he later claimed I didn't have. Here's what he wrote. Frank, I have a question about some of your claims. I'm not disputing them at this point, but I'm wondering what your authority for them is, i.e., how you know that what you say is right. Just to pick an example, on page 64 of volume 1 of Through Atheist Eyes, you indicate that Mithra was said to have been born of a virgin on December 25th. What makes you think so? I.e., who says that in the ancient world? And so on. That Mithra was worshipped on a Sunday, that he was depicted with a halo, that the leader of his cult was called Pope and ruled on the Vatican Hill, that his followers celebrated his atoning death, and that he was resurrected on a Sunday. What's the evidence for any of these statements, claims? Many thanks, Bart. Well, it just so happens that pages 120 through 145 of my chapter, Cognitive Dissonance, the Ehrman-Zindler correspondence, are filled in fine print with the evidence that I sent to Ehrman in answer to his request, a year before he was to claim that I did not supply such evidence. As you can see for yourself if you read my book, I supplied evidence from ancient coins, historians, archaeology, inscriptions, and even ancient Christian tombstones in Phrygia to support precisely all the things for which he asserted in print that I had no evidence. As you may have inferred, I was not the only target of Ehrman's critique. A number of my friends also found their names mentioned critically in his New York Times bestseller. Of course, no publicity is bad publicity, but no one likes to be unjustly criticized or be the object of even mild ridicule. And so six of my friends joined with me to write an answer to Ehrman's Did Jesus Exist? First of all, my co-editor, as well as co-author of this mythicist defense, is the famous New Testament scholar, Dr. Robert M. Price, the prolific author of books such as Deconstructing Jesus and many titles published by American Atheist Press. He wrote the detailed introduction containing capsule summaries of all the chapters of the book. He also wrote his own critique of Ehrman, pointing out that scholars are now in the midst of a so-called paradigm shift in understanding of the so-called historical Jesus. The famous atheist debater, historian, and classicist, Dr. Richard Carrier, also contributed an important chapter to the book. Carrier is becoming the standard bearer for a movement seeking to make the writing of history mathematically and scientifically more rigorous, especially by the application of Bayesian probability analyses of data. It's hard to be more controversial than I am, but my friend D.M. Murdock, who goes by the nom de plume of Acharya S., has me beat. Not surprisingly, Ehrman's critique of her was much more severe and, well, let me say it, outrageous than any of the other living scholars whose names are to be found in Did Jesus Exist? Let me read to you what Ehrman had to say on page 24 about her claim of the existence of a phallic statue of a man with a rooster head and a penis for a nose that she interprets as Saint Peter. Now, he's quoting Murdock's Christ Conspiracy book. He's quoting Acharya. Peter is not only, quote, the rock, but also the cock, or penis, as the word is used as slang to this day. Now, Bart Ehrman's comment. Here Acharya shows her own hand drawing of a man with a rooster head, but with a large erect penis instead of a nose, with this description, quoting Acharya now. Bronze sculpture hidden in the Vatican treasure of the cock. Symbol of Saint Peter. Then Bart says, there is no penis-nosed statue of Peter the cock in the Vatican or anywhere else except in books like this, which love to make things up. Ehrman ends with a sarcastic comment. In short, if there is any conspiracy here, it is not on the part of the ancient Christians who made up Jesus, but on the part of modern authors who make up stories about the ancient Christians and what they believed about Jesus. Well, Acharya, in Sanskrit, the name means teacher, had no trouble at all to document her claims, devoting one of her chapters in our book to do just that. The chapter is titled, "The Phallic Savior of the World, Hidden in the Vatican." Amusingly, she was able not only to show the antique source for the drawing, of course it wasn't her own sketch, of the rooster man with the phallic nose, she was able to come up even with an old photograph of the same type of statue, something that must have been quite common in ancient times. Well, she who laughs last. I've already introduced you to my first chapter in this book, Cognitive Dissonance, the Ehrman-Zindler Correspondence, in which I show that, in fact, I did supply enormous amounts of evidence to Ehrman, all of which he completely ignored. Because Ehrman feels that no one outside his narrow field of New Testament studies is competent or qualified to investigate the origins of Christianity or the so-called historical Jesus, I wrote a tongue-in-cheek chapter titled, "Is Bart Ehrman Qualified to Write About Christian Origins?" emphasizing, "Is Bart Ehrman qualified?" In it, I think I demonstrate that only a multidisciplinary approach to such studies can be adequate, and that he needs the cross-pollination, so to speak, that must come from other scholarly disciplines. Did Jesus exist is riddled with an enormous number of errors in informal logic and unscientific types of reasoning. Again and again, Ehrman commits the appeal to authority fallacy, drops in thinly veiled ad hominems, and reflexively repeats over and over the fallacy that medieval logicians called the ignotum per ignotius fallacy. That is, trying to explain the unknown in terms of the even more unknown. For that reason, my next chapter is titled Bart Ehrman and the Art of Rhetorical Fallacy. In that, I expose many, many such errors in reasoning. Now, the subtitle of Ehrman's book reads The Historical Argument for Jesus of Nazareth. Note that this implies that his book seeks to prove the historicity of not just any old Jesus, but the Jesus who came from Nazareth specifically. In my chapter titled Bart's Subtitle, I argue that in fact, absolutely none of the supposed evidence he adduces to try to prove the existence of an historical Jesus is specifically relevant to any Jesus of Nazareth. This is important because, as other chapters of this book show, there was no Nazareth at the time any historical Jesus should have been living there. No Land of Oz, no Wizard of Oz. No City of Nazareth, no Wizard of Nazareth. Ehrman practically concedes this, but argues nevertheless for the historicity of a Jesus of somewhere else. I don't have time in this short program to deal with all the places in Ehrman's book where he attacks my own personal views, let alone those of my co-authors. But I do want to tell you about one more point. It relates to my chapter with the rather dull title, Marx, Jesus from Nazareth of the Galilee. On page 191, Bart pays me a backhanded compliment with a rock in his glove. Frank Zindler, for example, in a cleverly titled essay, Where Jesus Never Walked, tries to deconstruct on a fairly simple level the geographical places associated with Jesus, especially Nazareth. He claims that Mark's gospel never states that Jesus came from Nazareth. This flies in the face, of course, of Mark 1:9, which indicates that this is precisely where Jesus came from. Quote, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee, unquote. But Zindler maintains that this verse was not originally part of Mark, It was inserted by a later scribe. Here again, we see history being done according to convenience. If a text says precisely what you think it could not have said, then all you need to do is claim that originally it must have said something else. So, all I needed to do was make up a claim? In that case, why did I supply all the evidence in emails to Bart indicating that the sole mention of Nazareth in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 1, verse 9, was an interpolation? Indeed, that the whole prologue of the Gospel of Mark was an interpolation. This gets more interesting. In a footnote, hidden at the end of his book on page 356, Ehrman turns around 180 degrees, and he says, this gets a bit technical, but I'll try to make it understandable. He says, I do not mean to say that Zindler does not cite evidence for his view. Well, then why is it that the immediate implication of what he said in his main text is exactly that? He claims that the name Jesus in Mark 1:9 does not have the definite article, unlike the other 80 places that it occurs in Mark, and therefore the verse does not appear to be written in Markan style. Now, Mark always speaks of the Jesus, and I think that this is an equivalent to him saying the Savior. Yeshua, you see, which is Yeshua's in Greek, means Savior in Aramaic. And I argue that Jesus, the word Jesus, originally was not a name, but rather a title. But to return to Bart's footnote. In response, I should say that A, there are two other places in Mark where the name Jesus does not have the article. Well, actually, there are seven. I told him there are seven places in Mark where Jesus doesn't have the definite article. And in the other six places, there are grammatical reasons why Jesus couldn't have the article. And then he says, B, if the problem with the entire verse is that the name Jesus does not have the article, then if we posit a scribal change to the text, the more likely explanation is that a scribe inadvertently left out the article. Nazareth has nothing to do with it, and C, there is not a single stitch of manuscript evidence to support his claim that the verse was interpolated into the gospel. This latter point is worth stressing, since it is the reason that no serious scholar, of course I am not a serious scholar, that no serious scholar of the textual tradition of Mark thinks that the verse is an interpolation. As I indicated, this is a very technical issue, and it is probably a bit foolish to try to explain it fully in a program that hopefully you'll be able to stay awake to the end of. The gist of the problem, however, is easily stated. Not only is verse 9 of Mark's first chapter the only place in the entire gospel where Jesus lacks the definite article when it was grammatically possible for it to do so, it's the only verse in the entire gospel where the word Nazareth appears, as opposed to many other cases where the King James Version mistranslates Greek words, actually meaning Nazarean or Nazarene, not the place name Nazareth. So, what's the probability that these two things would occur in the same one of 666 verses? In my chapter, I apply both frequentist and Bayesian probability methods to answer the question. Using traditional probability calculations, the answer is only about 1 in 200,000. And using Bayesian methods, it's even worse. All right, wake up out there. We're moving on to something else. My next co-author is the Canadian scholar Earl Doherty, who contributed 5 chapters to this book, and he rebuts a wide variety of Ehrman's arguments. Doherty is best known for his books The Jesus Puzzle and Jesus, Neither God Nor Man. However, he also has published a very fine refutation of Lee Strobel's deception manual, The Case for Christ. Doherty's book is titled Challenging the Verdict, A Cross-Examination of Lee Strobel's The Case for Christ. The only one of my co-authors who was not attacked in Ehrman's Did Jesus Exist is David Fitzgerald, author of the very popular book Nailed, 10 Christian Myths That Show Jesus Never Existed at All. Fitzgerald takes the clever approach to Ehrman's arguments of quoting Ehrman against Ehrman. He shows how Ehrman's earlier and best books actually present convincing arguments against any historical Jesus. Fitzgerald's chapter was of great interest to me for the reason that it confirmed an opinion I had held for nearly 25 years about the logical endpoint of Ehrman's scholarly path. I've been a member of the Society of Biblical Literature for nearly 30 years now, and for more than 20 of those years I have been watching the scholarly developments of two biblical scholars, Bart Ehrman and Robert Price. Long ago, I predicted that they both would become atheists and both would become mythicists. It seemed inevitable given the trends of their research. Well, I was right about one thing. Both Ehrman and Price became atheists, but I was 50% wrong about them both becoming mythicists. Price did become a mythicist, and in fact, he's my co-author of this volume and my co-editor. Ehrman, of course, did not, despite the clear directionality of all his research, going all the way back to his doctoral dissertation. Anyhow, Fitzgerald's chapter, Will the Real Jesus Please Stand Up, is a delight to read, and I hope you'll all get this book and read what he has to say. One of the most important chapters in our reply to Bart Ehrman is the chapter written by Rene Salm, Archaeology, Bart Ehrman, and the Nazareth of Jesus. This chapter summarizes the voluminous amounts of evidence Salm has amassed in recent years to show that the present-day town of Nazareth did not exist at the turn of the era. Now, I've already commented about the extraordinary implications of that fact for historical Jesus studies. Salm's chapter debunks an important part of so-called New Testament archaeology, a field that, for the most part, has simply been a creation science-like branch of Christian apologetics. Incidentally, in volume one of my Red Books, Through Atheist Eyes, I have a chapter where Jesus never walked. As you remember, that was one of the chapters criticized by Ehrman. Anyhow, in that chapter, I showed that many other places in the Gospels are also fictional. They're literary inventions. Check it out. Someday, I'll do some special programs on Nazareth and the other fictive places of the New Testament. Well, I've spent quite a bit of time on just this one book, but I think it's important that you all understand how it relates to this book, Did Jesus Exist? And that you get some idea of what the historical Jesus controversy is all about. I urge you all to get a copy of Bart Ehrman's Did Jesus Exist? And read it. He's a good writer, and you'll enjoy his style. But then, get this book and see if we have answered Ehrman's arguments adequately or not. Bart Ehrman and the Quest of the Historical Jesus of Nazareth, an evaluation of Ehrman's Did Jesus Exist, is available in paperback edition on the American Atheists website, www.atheists.org, as well as on Amazon. It also can be had in a Kindle ebook edition on Amazon. It's difficult to think of any question that is more important than did Jesus ever exist? Religion is the biggest industry on the planet, the ignorance industry, I would call it, And the economic implications of a negative answer to that question are staggering. It behooves us all to try to discover the truth of this matter. American Atheist Press has a number of other books that you will want to study as well. Several of them are written by Robert Price, and like all his books, are a pleasure to read. This one, The Christ Myth Theory and Its Problems, like volume one of my Red books, was criticized by Ehrman in Did Jesus Exist? And so, after you've read Ehrman's book and the joint effort rebuttal book I've just been telling you about, you'll want to get a copy of this book by Price. In The Christ Myth Theory and Its Problems, Price recounts his own intellectual journey from belief in an historical Jesus to his conclusion that Jesus is just as mythical as Hercules. In other words, how and why he became a mythicist. A large part of the book is a tour de force, disembowelment of the Gospels. Every kink in the small intestines, every wrinkle and ridge in the transcending colon is exposed to the light of critical analysis and shown not to have ever been a part of the digestive tract of any historical Jesus. Price was one of the more skeptical members of the Jesus Seminar when its deliberations ended, and it concluded that only about 18% of the supposed sayings of Jesus were authentic. Price argued that even the 18% was spurious. The present book finishes the work of the Jesus Seminar and shows that absolutely nothing in the Gospels can be attributed to any Jesus of Nazareth. Another book by Robert Price that is relevant to the historical Jesus question is his delightful, whimsically titled book, The Historical Bejesus, What a Long, Strange Quest It's Been. In it, Price details not only the various Jesuses invented by both mainline and out-of-line scholars, he also details the theories of many mythicists of the 20th and 21st centuries. He even takes notice of one of my own earlier mythicist adventures, my book, The Jesus the Jews Never Knew. In this book, I showed that there are absolutely no references to any historical Jesus in any Jewish literature surviving from antiquity, despite numerous claims to the contrary. I devote a large hunk of the book to showing how already in ancient times, Christians were forging documents and interpolating the writings of historians like Josephus, in order to prove that their would-be Messiah had, in fact, once lived. The last American Atheist Press book I need to tell you about today is this little one that I published back in 1997, 2 years after the murder of American Atheist's founder, Madeline Murray O'Hare, and her family. It's called The Legend of St. Peter, and it is my annotated translation from German into English of a little book written by the greatest German mythicist of the early 20th century, Otto Dres. Now, although it's spelled D-R-E-W-S, it's not pronounced Drews, it's pronounced Dres, just so you know. Dres showed that the Apostle Peter, like his would-be master Jesus, was also a fictional, mythical person. I'll leave you with one last shocking bit of information. There is not one shred of historical or archaeological evidence to show that any of the 12 disciples or apostles ever lived, nor St. Paul, for that matter. In some other program, we'll deal with that startling claim. Okay, that's all for today. Until next time, for American Atheists and for the cause of reason, I'm Frank Zindler. Thank you.